surf area in Hawaii next year. So thank you guys for making the time today. All of you, you know, it's my honor to have all of you, because, you know, I know it's really hard to get everybody in the same room at the same time. So maybe just to start off the conversation, you know, of course, you know, the DCIL, myself included, was kind of behind this whole project. I reached out to Jesper and was kind of half praying that, you know, he would say yes to working together. But I think for the rest of you, you kind of were brought into this project by Jesper, right? So maybe just to start off, you know, I wanted to kind of go down memory lane a little bit. When you got the call from Jesper about this project, what was the first thing that went through your mind? And what made you say yes to, you know, being part of this? Other than, you know, I'm sure Jesper probably, you know, threatened you or something, but... Or Jesper, you can start with, you know, me calling you and saying, hey, do you want to work together? And you trying to figure out who is this crazy person.
Yeah, sure. Yeah. So, so I've been working on NFT projects since earlier this year. I became aware of it through my friend James Jean, who did his first sell on Foundation. And then Human invited me to be a part of that platform to try to sell my first NFT. And my very first one was more sort of, in terms of my Genesis piece, just to see how it worked. And luckily I had like a little bit of ETH to sort of use as seed capital for just purchasing, paying for gas fees and minting cost. And so I was able to put my first one up, and I was lucky that it sold. But then I haven't been really fully focused on pursuing NFTs until more recent months, where I, you know, was a part of a Nifty Gateway release, you know, MakersPlace with this one, an auction in Hong Kong through Poly Auction, etc. And then there's been a bunch more that I've been working on, that I'm going to have more releases coming up as well. And so it's been great to sort of use it. I don't think of it as like my main sort of work, but it's sort of another avenue to promote my work, because what I felt initially when I first started doing it was I thought that my current collector base and following base would transfer over to the NFT crypto world, but I learned that that wasn't the case, that at the end of the day, like crypto enthusiasts and people that own cryptocurrency is still very niche. Like, there's a lot of people that don't own crypto. I mean, like, most people in my family, like, they have no clue what I'm talking about when I bring it up. And the NFT community within the crypto community is a niche within the niche. And so I learned that I really had to sort of almost rebuild my art career within that space, because people within that space, collectors within that space, don't really know who I am. And why would they invest in my work or purchase my work if they don't know who I'm doing, or if they don't see that I'm committed to doing more work within that space. So I've been slowly working and continuing working within there. So then when Ellen reached out, I've been keeping my doors open for like sort of any NFT projects. Like, I'll just try and see what happens. And so I was more than open. And then when Ellen brought up, I told her that we need to, you know, work with a solid platform to promote, that we're willing to promote the work of artists. Because what I found on certain platforms is that you're often allowed to sort of put up work, but the platforms themselves don't really help to onboard or promote or sell work on their side. So luckily MakersPlace was willing to do that. And the goal was to get more artists from Hawaii to sell and be a part of the NFT community and sell NFTs. And we put together a list, and together with MakersPlace, we kind of created and picked like the first set of artists to be a part of this project, which are the artists that you see before you. And so, you know, and then from there, it's just sort of reaching out to everyone to see like who'd even be interested, you know, and who'd be willing to sort of like take that plunge into that world. And luckily everyone said yes, and we were able to sort of make this MakersPlace release happen.
That's awesome. So for the rest of you, what made you say yes when Jesper called and asked you about NFTs, given that it's a Genesis, you know, release for most of you, right?
Yeah, well, whenever Jasper comes to us with a project, I feel like we're pretty open to it because he's good about making sure that he's working with quality partners. And, you know, we've worked with him since 2013, so a long time. and so we know that he's not going to come to us with something that's going to waste our time. Like, it's going to be worth it. It's going to be a cool opportunity. So we're immediately open to anything that he kind of throws out there. Then it just becomes a matter of like, do we have the time? Does it fit within work maybe that we've done before, that it's a continuation of that? So we were really excited actually, because we'd been hearing about the NFT space for a while, but it's kind of that thing where it's a whole new world, right? Like he said, people don't necessarily know what it is. And we each kind of dived in a little bit into just trying to learn about it. But if you have gone into that space, you just know how overwhelming it is.
There are little dives.
There were very like, tiny dives. And then it's like, whoa, oh, let's go back. I don't know if we're ready for this yet. You know, there's so many access points and you're just like, I don't want to do this wrong. Like, yeah. Where do I start? So we were really excited to jump on this with Jasper because, like he said, you know, it was going to be with a quality platform. We'd have some help onboarding. Mm-hmm. And then just being able to do it with these awesome artists as well. It wasn't like we're just going in there on our own. Mm-hmm. So then it made us feel a lot more comfortable saying yes.
Yep. And maybe one thing I'd add too, just real quick, was that Jasper touched on the idea of it being a space where your current fans don't necessarily transfer over. And it's kind of an exciting part about it too, that you're sort of starting with a blank slate. And you're looking at it from the lens of an artist who's knows the process of creating work and getting it out there. But now you're like, okay, we're starting from the base again. And the challenge is to engage with a new audience. It's fun.
Any other thoughts? Lucky, Char, Aaron?
So when Jasper asked me, I mean, I have had crypto for a really long time. I'm not like, that's only by way of association because my brother-in-law used to mine Bitcoin back like in 2010. So I kind of get it, but NFTs was completely like, I feel like every time I would ask somebody, like, what, just can you just explain to me what an NFT is? And all they would just tell me is like, it's a non-fungible token. Like, I'm supposed to understand what that means. So I was a little bit nervous, but basically when Jasper asks me to do anything, I'll just say yes, because I like working with him and he does so many good things. And anyone who's worked with him will tell you the same thing. Like, I love Jasper. He's such a good guy. And you can trust that you're getting into a quality project. And then for me, I feel like I'm kind of the rookie with all these guys. And like, I have admired all of these artists for so long. So it's just like, for me, it's like a fangirl moment. Like, oh, I get to get into a project with some of my heroes, you know? So that's kind of what got me into it. Super happy. I feel like I've learned a lot from just starting to get into the NFTs. So I'm now more excited about it. I think there's a lot of potential in this space. So I'm just grateful to be a part of it.
Awesome. Lucky, Aaron, any thoughts?
Yeah, I think, like she said, this is like a big learning process. I've been kind of into crypto maybe since February, more just investing and watching YouTube videos and like Wooden Wave. I just tried to go down the rabbit hole and just learn what was a good project, what wasn't. But once NFTs came around, I was like, Char, like, confused, what is this? And but it was a learning process. And I think what Jasper was saying is your market base transferring over. But now that we're doing this, learning about how to build a project, maybe do a write-up about it and just build something that's going to progress and not just like a one and done. And I think building your fan base on a crypto platform is like totally new and very like, it's different. It's definitely a lot of learning, but I'm more interested in it and I look forward to doing more and hopefully it sells. Yeah, congratulations to everybody that sold out on their first day. That was pretty rad. So that gives me hope. But yeah, thanks for letting me be a part of it.
Thank you, Lucky. Aaron?
For me, it was it's definitely a learning experience. I tried to get into Bitcoin before the pandemic, and I lost like a good amount of money because I didn't know what I was doing. So it made me very, very fearful of getting into it. And then when the pandemic hit, a lot of friends were getting into, you know, the NFT stuff, and I was just in the background on Clubhouse watching and listening and stuff. And I still didn't really get a hold of it. So once I start seeing my friends doing it, it was like, oh man, I need to figure this out because it's just another market. And it was just very interesting, you know, platform. And when Jasper hit me up, you know, I love working with Jasper and with the Powwow crew. They're bridge makers. They cover a lot of ground and they do a lot of cool positive stuff. And I looked at it, you know, as school with my fellow Islanders, and it was just a good way to get into it and learn just with the people that I've done festivals and projects with. So yeah, thanks Jasper for the invite, and shout out to everybody involved.
Awesome, thank you guys. So I'm just gonna bring up really quickly this little video that I stole from Jasper, because he went into crypto voxels and did this really cool walkthrough of the virtual gallery. So I just wanted to share it with the rest of the people on the call so that they know what we're talking about. Let's see, how do I get out this screen? Okay. So for those in the audience, if you have not seen this, this was our artist's awesome artworks in the metaverse or the virtual gallery that was put up by MakersPlace. So, sorry, my computer is like super slow, but yeah. Awesome. So
that music is not actually in there. I put that music on the video because it's Alice in Wonderland.
Yeah, I know. I stole the whole video from your from Instagram.
I saw you guys are going in there. Like, how come they don't play that song? It's licensed by Disney.
Well, so I know copyright. Sorry about that. But you know, I mean, what were your thoughts when you saw that in, you know, your artworks up there in this, you know, virtual gallery? Do you know, were you blown away? Were you like, oh, this is okay, got it. This is what it means. Yeah.
Yeah, I think it's a totally new frontier, really, when you think of how your work is being shown. I know for us, like, we're really into the idea of world building and like, how can our tree houses and the things that we illustrate live in a different space? Like, people are always asking us, like, when are you going to build a tree house? And the thing is, like, none of our treehouse designs could ever get permitted because they're so dangerous and funky, right? But they can exist in the metaverse. So that's what's kind of cool, is that you can have these avatars that walk through a space and they can see work that's 2D, but there's also the potential to make things 3D. So technically, like, an avatar could play in one of our treehouses or something like that. So just kind of getting a small window into the possibility of where this could go, because technology just goes at such a crazy rate, right? Like, when we were in middle school is when, like, the internet became a public thing that we could do. So you know, within our lifetimes, it's going to be crazy, the possibilities of what can happen in the metaverse. So yeah, when he shared that video, it's just like, whoo, oh my gosh, okay, you just have to almost start thinking in a different way of what's possible.
I mean, I think, like, I mean, I agree with Wooden Wave, where I think our generation, we grew up in the creation of the internet, and we were exposed to the internet and computers when we were a bit older, like, you know, like middle school, high school. I got my first computer when I was in high school, and we were still running dial-up. You know, it was still like that thing. So, but then if you look at our kids, like, they already live in the metaverse. Like, almost every kid I know, like, exists in the real world. They have their life there and they have their digital lives, whether it be Minecraft or Roblox or Fortnite or Apex Legends or whatever. Like, every single child now has two lives. They have their metaverse life and they have their real world life, and they have their personas and even like their homes. Like my daughter like builds her house on like Bloxburg and Adopt Me, and she tries to like ask me for, and the only thing she wants for her birthdays and Christmases is Robux, so that she can like buy more stuff and clothes for her avatars and everything. So as these kids get older, they've already adapted, they're already acclimated to the metaverse. Like they're already living both lives. They already have, it's already built in that they have a digital life and a real world life. So it's gonna be interesting to see as we get older and see them get older and how the stuff that we're doing now adapts. And that's where like NFTs are really gonna explode, because people are gonna want, you know, they're gonna want that sort of exclusive skin. You know, right now, if you're on Fortnite, everyone can buy that skin. So you jump in, you'll see like 50 other people wearing the same clothes as you, or 20 other people. But then people are like, you know what, I'm gonna buy one that maybe only 10 people have, you know? And that sort of limited edition collector mentality, which we've had since we were kids, because we used to all collect baseball cards, basketball cards, Pokemon cards, mobile cards, like that collector mentality. Or even like as you get older, then you're like collecting sneakers or toys. I mean, look behind Woes, man, like he's a major collector. I don't even have that many toys. I'm like jealous. Like I have prints and paintings from friends. But we all have that, like that collector mentality is like built in, you know, it's like, it's built into like who we are as people. And the understanding and the need to collect is sort of inherent in our DNA. And collecting, and then so once we start accepting that we can also collect it digitally, and that exists, and which is start, and which exists now because of NFTs, then it's going to be like sort of widely done across the board, which we're seeing, because now Nike bought R2 FKT, and this is doing a collection with NFT PFPs, and so it's already sort of like kind of entering into the mainstream in some degree. But I think we'll see more and more of that. I think for me, it was more like, I was like, man, I wish the resolution was higher on our pieces in that gallery, in that digital gallery. Because we're at a point where, like, if you play console games, like sometimes you play games, you're like, it looks real. And so I've been lucky where I have my collection with the NBA and WNBA. You can buy my clothes on NBA 2K. And I wear that around in sort of the NBA metaverse. And people can see me wearing my own clothes in the game. So, which is really fun too. Like, so sort of seeing some of your stuff that exists in the real world sort of transfer over. And so almost like every single client I'm doing work with now, it's almost like say I'm working with Spalding right now. And so we're like, okay, can we do a project? And, or, you know, can we also do like an NFT release with the project? And how can we tie in collecting the physical and the digital product? So I think it's really starting to shift a lot, especially I think this year was the year that shifted a ton, and next year it's going to be even more so. So it's good to jump in now and sort of seeing how you can. And so now when you have a client like, oh, can I also do an NFT release? You're like, okay, yeah, I know how I can do that. You know, like this is what we can do, et cetera, et cetera. So shifting a lot. But yeah, it's cool to sort of see more and more of that, because there's a bunch of different metaverses right now. Decentraland, Sandbox, you know, and the ones that our kids play, like Roblox, et cetera.
Thanks, Jesper. Any thoughts from the rest? Have you guys all seen it, by the way? Or is this the first time you're seeing it in that virtual gallery for some of you?
I saw it. It's cool. I like it. I play a lot of video games. So yeah, like what Jasper was saying, like there's still a lot of like, you know, as far as the graphics go down, but I can also see it, you know, it's like we're getting into like the Ready Player One kind of vibes. And I like it. I think it's dope that like we can send people to places like that, and they can check out a whole gallery that's virtual. I think it's awesome.
Cool. Any thoughts, Lucky or Shar?
Yeah, I think once everything solidifies and we all end up on one or two platforms, whenever that is, you know, 1 year, 5 years, but that video or that display in that gallery was pretty much exactly what I was trying to explain to people. Like they're like, what is an NFT? Why would I buy one? What can I do with it? And it's like a digital flex, you know, like you can show it and you can pretty much get anyone in any country to show up to this gallery. And walk around or fly, that even has like a flying feature, you know, that you could like fly around the city. But yeah, once, I mean, I know that was probably put together in such a short amount of time, but given, you know, technology and graphic design and all that, I think it's going to be amazing in the future. It might even be like a few years from now, you know, but I liked it. I thought it was pretty rad.
Any thoughts, Char?
Yeah, I think seeing that actually was like my like aha moment, or like it finally clicked for me. You know, like Jasper was saying, we all kind of grew up collecting stuff. I was really big into collecting erasers. But seeing that kind of was like, oh, like the adult connection was made, you know, like, oh, this is like the next place we can go. And I mean, it really like got my brain going, like all the different places you can take your NFTs and just the potential. It's really exciting, you know, because as artists, we always like, we want to grow and challenge ourselves. And this is like the new challenge for us, is to build these worlds that just kind of live in our heads and get to share that with everybody.
Mm-hmm. Thanks. So I think the next thing I want to kind of talk about with you guys is, you know, your the NFT artworks that you chose for this project. I think for most of you, it's your Genesis artwork. And I think for most of you, it's something that you already have out in the physical world, probably except for Jasper's, I think. So maybe let's just, you know, walk through that, and, you know, so that, you know, our audience can understand its rationale behind it, in terms of what, like how you chose your art pieces and why those were the ones that you put up for this project. So let me go, I think we're gonna go in alphabetical order. So yeah, Jasper's, your first as Jasper Wong, and I know you have a new one up there. So for those who missed out, because Jasper sold everything from this release, so if you missed out, there's one more. It's a new one that he put up recently, so you still have a chance to collect it. Jasper, do you want to just, you know, quickly share like the inspiration behind this collection and why you chose to do this for this project?
Yeah, for sure. So the one thing, like in the past, I've mainly sold sort of like one-of-ones and done auctions, and I wanted to play around with doing something where maybe it would trigger a collector to want to collect more, to sort of, and then be rewarded if you do get all of them. So there's four colorful pieces, and there's addition, and there are additions of 10. And if you collect all four, then I gift you the full piece. And I also then release sort of a more of a black and white one of one as well. So that ended up being total like 41 pieces. And what I failed to realize is that if you're gonna like mint that many, you gotta pay gas fees for 41 pieces.
Yeah.
And gas fees are expensive. And when I started doing it, I was like, uh-oh. Cause for some reason in my head, I thought, oh, I just have to like pay for gas fees for one, and then it just additions it to 10. But that's not true, because then you have to like mint and do gas fees for each individual one. So that's like 41. Then I started looking at gas fees when I was doing it during the daytime. I'm like, it was like up to like $200 something. And I was like $200, and I have to do like 41. So I was like in the middle of the night, like just like hoping the prices go down. So I was like minting and doing gas fees like 1 or 2 a.m. in the middle of the night, hoping that'll go down. And luckily, like whenever it went down to under 100, I would do it. So I think average was between like 50 to 80 that night when I was doing it. And I had to do them like one by one. It wasn't like, oh, do a bulk 10 or do bulk 41. It was like, do one, done. Okay, did another one. Okay, what are the gas fees with this next one? Because it might shift within those seconds, and which it did. And then there's one point where I was like, it started going back up to like 100 something. And I was like, in my head, it was like, should I just mint this so I can go to sleep, or should I wait? Or should I do it tomorrow? No, because I'm just gonna pay for it so I can just go to bed. And so it was like very anxiety inducing, because then you're like, okay, I hope it sells, because then I kind of like put a lot of money in. And if it doesn't sell, then, you know, I'm kind of like out like a bit. So I kind of like put myself into this hole, and I'm luckily like I was able to sell out, which is godsend, because I was like really concerned. I was like, I don't know what's gonna happen. And a lot of people actually purchased all four. So it ended up working out. Then I put up a new one and that hasn't sold yet. So it's just like, you know, sort of common, like, you know, like it happens. My friends that are in the game are always like, you know what, think of it as a marketplace. Like it might not sell right away, but it might sell months later. Like I put up one in March and it sold like, one of them sold like 7 months later or something. So, you know, so I don't like to stress out about it. I just like leave it there. You know, It is what it is. And then as I do more projects and build more projects with other companies, then hopefully people look back and they're like, oh, this one's for sale. I mean, they get it, you know? So it's really sort of building your reputation within that world. And hopefully as you build it, then people are interested in the work that you've put up previously. But this particular piece is really based on, you know, our generation, us, like, you know, in this group, growing up with Saturday morning cartoons. You know, we didn't have streaming. You know, it wasn't sort of like this sort of like open option where I can just turn on the TV and watch whatever I wanted and watch whatever episode I wanted. It was like, you had the shows that you watched and you had to watch them every Saturday. And if you missed an episode, because your parents were making you go to eat dim sum or something Saturday morning, then you were screwed and you missed that whole thing. And then you don't know what the hell happened the previous week. And you kind of had to fill in the dots with that. This is what happened previously, you know, little segment before the cartoon. And in hopes that maybe they'll do like a replay, or maybe your parents will let you borrow the set, rent the set from Blockbuster or something. So that kind of like grew up that way, you know? You're like, oh, you kind of like filled in pieces in your head. And also I really love smear frames. So in the animation, when you make something go fast, you don't increase the frame rate or like draw more pieces. You kind of like make them, you kind of like skew them. You kind of stretch them out to make it look like they're going fast. And if you pause it in smear frames, they're the funniest imagery of like cartoons. And I look at a lot of them because I think they're super funny. And so I just kind of wanted to incorporate sort of that world and my childhood with smear frames and just kind of something that was more fun and kind of harken back to sort of, you know, when I was a kid and what I enjoyed watching and being exposed to. And I think all of those cartoons is really what inspired me to be an artist. Because as a kid, I wanted to be a cartoonist because I thought that was the only career you could do. Doing that kind of work, it was like either a comic book artist or a cartoonist. And then when I got older, I realized I don't really have the patience for it. Because I would try to do a comic book and I'm like, I can only do like a page and I'm like done. So, but you know, it's really in respect to those guys. I even have a tattoo of Hanna-Barbera on my leg, just out of respect for for those two guys that like did so much work in their lifetime, you know, like the amount of work they've done and the influence they've had, it's incredible. So it's really that.
Awesome, thank you. I know it was you sold out in like 24 hours, I think 41 editions. We were like, oh, you know.
Yeah, I think I was lucky, and luckily, like I also have friends that are like crypto influencers, so they help to push. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I found that it's important to sort of, you know, what it really is, community. Is like, you have to spend a lot of time on Twitter these days. It's like tweeting, because then people don't care about Instagram as much within that world. Because also Instagram has like these crazy algorithms that kind of like reduce engagement, and they just do it randomly and they remove features and you're like, what's going on? So people get really upset with Instagram. So they tend to leave the platform for alternatives because they don't trust it. Which is the same with Facebook, right? So, because then they also own Instagram. So, and then Zuckerberg stole the name Metaverse. So, you know, it's like trademarking the word internet, you know, but.
Well, we can have another conversation about that for sure.
but yeah, so, you know, it's really like sort of meeting people, tweeting, you know, joining Discords, mm-hmm. or buying PFP so you can join Discords and be part of different communities.
So Lucky, this was a very interesting piece that I saw. It, you know, what prompted you? And this is was this an original creation just for these for this project, or was it something that you had already previously?
It was 50-50. So the snake woman was created for a t-shirt design, and Jasper, he was like, you know, you can use something that you've already done so you don't stress out about it. But it was so plain that I didn't want to just put it out. And then you're going through NFT platforms or, you know, watching people sell NFTs. I was like, this needs to be more interesting. And especially he's scared me when he was like, oh, this is your first one, it's very important, you know. It's like, oh, I better make this look good. So it was 50-50. And then I had added in the background later for a little bit pizzazz. But I don't know, the idea behind it is definitely like to try and make it, like with tattooing, everything's very systematic and you can't do too much to it. But I think with this hot pink and this kind of funky, weird blend, you know, like that's something that I always like. But you couldn't do that on a person, but in the metaverse or in an NFT, or, you know, like he was saying, his daughter buys skins and blocks and, you know, like someone could actually purchase this and maybe possibly wear it on their digital body. And it could be as funky or as bright or as vibrant as you want it. Like, I mean, if you look at everybody's tattoos, they're pretty much black, you know, red, green, yellow, but nobody, you couldn't really execute this as well on skin. I mean, you can, I've seen it done, but, you know, maybe you don't want to wear it in the real world, but you would in the digital world. So that was the kind of the idea behind that. But yeah, I wish I had more time. I would have definitely planned it out a little bit more like Jasper did, but he's like a veteran. So we're just following in his footsteps.
Yeah. Well, I mean, the best thing is you took your first step, right? So, you know, there's just so much. Well, there's a lot of space here. They could add more artworks. That's what you're saying.
Yeah,
so,
yeah. And I think with putting that first one up, it definitely made me think of, okay, how should I approach this and what should I do next? I shouldn't just throw some up there and hopefully somebody grabs it. Mm-hmm. But yeah, trying to get a new, I don't know, like a new following I'm still trying to figure all that out, you know, like why would someone in crypto and NFTs want this style of artwork, you know? So if I can figure that out, you know, hopefully in the future everything will work out. But I'm glad I did it, and yeah, it's half original, half something I had prior. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I think it's awesome.
Thank you,
Lucky. Okay, let's go to Char. Char, you have two really amazing ones too. And very
distinct. Yes. yeah, so similar to Lucky, you know, like I was kind of I was stressed out, like I in my brain I was like, oh, I'm gonna kill this, like I'm gonna make something brand new and it's gonna be, you know, well thought out. And then of course I'm like everybody else, you just get super super busy. I was like on Outer Island working on a mural, like for I think the whole, like I was one mural for a week, and then I had to jump to the other side of the island and do another one on the big island. And I was like stressing out, like, oh my God, like I'm gonna fail. I'm not gonna have this done in time. And Jasper's gonna be mad at me. So he's like, no, Char, just use something you have. So I kind of just went through my little catalog and I just kind of went to see like, okay, maybe this one will do well or this one. So try to get them a little bit different from each other just to like test the waters. But of course, if I could go back, I would definitely approach this a little bit differently and think more as like a collection of things. I think in my mind it was just like, well, either one of these could kind of branch out into its own kind of a collection, whether it be like these like sort of crazy headpieces or this random world of, you know, flat graphic shapes. So yeah, that was my thinking. I mean, again, looking forward to like just kind of growing in the space. But those pieces alone, I mean, are some of my favorites. So that's just kind of I wanted to share that.
Mm-hmm. And you have this like, well, I mean, no one can afford to buy it at $1,000. You have this as a physical item right now that you're selling, correct?
Right. Yeah, I forgot. That's what I was also thinking, is like, I knew I was going to release that as a towel. So I was going to see like how that works. Cause again, that was something I was completely lost on. Like, why would anybody want something that's already out there as something that you're mass producing as a physical object? Why would they want to buy that as a digital thing? So I think I just kind of wanted to see how that works and plays out. I think Jasper tried to explain it to me, like, yeah, you know, it takes me a minute for things to really kind of like make sense in my head. But yes, that's a towel.
Yeah, so, you know, I think you should promote it and say, if you, you know, if you don't want to tell, we have, you know, another version for you. That's an NFT, so check it out.
Expensive, but yeah.
Cool, thanks, Jar. Aaron, yours sold really quickly too. Your so-called happy pandas or...
Again, yeah, I wanted to do something new too, but I've been really swamped doing projects and stuff. And I had this graphic sitting in my iPad for a while, and it was actually released as a rug for an art show. So there are two made with this design. So I was like, it's kind of a series that I do called Wall of Fear and Fang, and it's just a bunch of them chilling. And I've been placing these characters for over 20 years now around the world, like just painting them on murals and doing projects with them. And when the opportunity came to enter the metaverse with it, I was just like, yo, it's time for them to come and enter this world and populate this planet. So yeah, I just wanted to put these crazy bears out into this world, and now I'm in there, so I'm stoked, you know.
Cool. We'll talk about next steps and everything later, but thanks.
Yes.
Roxy and Matt, yours sold too, and it was really pretty fast, I think within 24 hours, I guess.
Yeah, thanks. So we do illustrations and paintings of these sustainable treehouse communities, and so we chose these two pieces. They're two of our favorites. The first one is like a pirate ship got marooned onto shore and got repurposed into this surf and science outpost over the ocean there. So we want the viewer to imagine themselves as someone who is in that space, who gets to live there and then also work there.
Maybe they're like a marine biologist, researcher. It's kind of like a facility of sorts.
Yeah.
So
it's got water catchment, green roofs, solar panels. And then of course you want to have fun in life. So there's a skate ramp there, mm-hmm. With some surfboards, because there's a really nice break that we painted in there as well. So you can do a surf on your lunch break. With each of our pieces, we write out a little narrative. So if you were to go to our MakersPlace link, you could then read kind of something that we've put out. I won't read it because it takes a little bit of time, but you can just see that there.
We put a lot of energy into the narrative, and that's something that we do it because they're really detailed pieces, and so you can kind of dive into it and kind of find these different parts that we're writing about. But also we really enjoy, like Roxy had said earlier, like creating a story, a narrative that sort of gives context to the image. And I think that kind of ties in with the idea that these are landscapes, these are dream dwellings, we're calling them, that you would imagine yourself living in. And we hope that, you know, you can look at this and you can be like maybe drinking your coffee and just kind of zoning out and looking in there and be like, oh wow, yeah, you know, they've got an arcade in there. And wait, is that a right next to the arcade, there's a tiny little like first aid kit. Why would they have a first aid kit? Oh, because there's a half pipe skate ramp that's like 20 feet above the forest floor. You probably need a, you know, a tourniquet every once in a while when you fall. Just like, well, a little bit of
just
like
skating is a dangerous sport, yeah, in itself.
But in a treehouse, it's like exponentially so dangerous.
Yeah. So this is Dream Dwelling Boombox Treehouse. So it's the treehouse in the shape of a boombox. So mm-hmm. every part of that space has a function. So like as a boombox, where the speakers are is where the skate ramp is. Mm-hmm. The place where the cassette deck would be is the deck, like the lanai. So we like to be punny when we can. The little bar that's there is called the mixtapes. You can get your favorite mixed drink, whether that's a smoothie or a margarita, you know.
Yeah, there you go.
So we like to have fun with the spaces, and the idea of making a collection called Dream Dwellings is that these places don't exist physically, but mm-hmm. they exist like in your imagination, and your imaginary self can live there with your friends or your family. Mm-hmm. Which we feel is like a really cool kind of connection to the metaverse in itself, because it is kind of like this fantasy world. So that's what's really fun to play around with.
And then maybe lastly, I would say, like, we're trying to, like everyone else, we're trying to figure out what it is that makes these things collectible. And so for our scenario where we create these kind of treehouse dwellings, sustainable wonderland kind of things, we're kind of planning on calling them all dream dwellings, and then we put the colon and then the name of what the, so this one is dream dwelling colon boombox treehouse, the other one is dream dwelling colon surf and science research outposts. And looking down the line, and we're actually ready to release another one that's a pineapple treehouse, and it would be dream dwelling pineapple treehouse. But looking down the line, we're looking at like populating our own sort of, say, like a map that includes all these different treehouses and different types of like a rainforest, an ocean, a desert. So you have this like different ecologies, and there's a collectability to collecting each one. And then also there could be a map that would follow up afterwards. So
right.
So I think follow through and utility is what we're looking at.
And this is like a bunch of NFT jargon. So utility, I feel like a lot of people are like, what are you talking about? So one of the things that's interesting about NFTs is that people talk about utility, and what they mean is, besides having this image that they get, is mm-hmm. there something else that they get with it? Usually when you buy a painting in the physical world, you buy the painting, you put it, you know, up in your living room, and that's the end of that. But what's cool about the NFT space is people are trying to build a community around what they're selling. So not only do you get access to the image, but you might also get the ability to be invited to exclusive events where only people who own NFTs from that maker are able to go to those mm-hmm. events.
Whether that's in the real world or the metaverse world.
Right.
Yeah, anything.
Exclusive merchandise that you're able to buy that maybe has your NFT printed on mm-hmm. it. So for us, we're thinking down the line of whoever has an NFT of our dream dwellings images, they're in our community of dream dwellers. So the dream dwellers could have access to this map, and the map has all the ecosystems where we would, mm-hmm. you know, have pins for, it's like, oh, the NFT that you bought is here on the map. So that's kind of what Matt was referring to. Yeah. So that way, people who buy our NFTs, it's not just this one-off thing that they buy and collect, but they also become part of this community called the Dream Dwellers. Mm-hmm. And whatever we decide to kind of incentivize sales with, those Dream Dwellers have access to that.
It kind of like goes hand in hand with like a video game where you're just like unlocking a new level. And so that's kind of where we're hoping to steer our direction.
Yeah, thanks.
And that was what I was trying to tell Lucky to sort of like explore, because Lucky is considered sort of one of the best, if not the best, tattoo artist on the island, and his wait list is like 20 years or something. So by the time you get an appointment with him, you like might not even have like skin. So, you know, I say, you know, if someone buys your NFT, then maybe they can get a tattoo of the NFT, you know. I mean, granted, then you have to sort of set the initial bid at sort of how much you would want to get paid for that. That sort of like has that as a minimum. But you know, people like Gary Vee do that, and you know, and really his NFTs are mainly point of access. Depending on what you have access to his talks or even like meeting him. Kings of Leon did that, even Gronk did that, you know. So people are using NFTs sort of like, hey, these are like exclusive membership cards that if you have these NFTs and you can show you have it on your MetaMask wallet, etc., then you know, then you can go to these events or you can meet people or you can. And that's sort of what's driven the PFP world, right? With the Basies and the CryptoPunks and the Doodles and the Cool Cats and blah, 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 blah. They all have access to like the Discords and to real life events, et cetera. Sort of like providing that utility through NFTs. But yeah, so, you know, so then I was like, you know, people that have that kind of ability to do that where like you can't even get an appointment with Lucky, maybe the NFT is the only way to do so. Yeah.
Buy the NFT right now.
Well, you have 5 that's available out there.
What's funny is I noticed that Matt and Roxy were maybe the most nervous about getting into this, or maybe we're all nervous, but they, just listening to them talk, they have such a good plan, and they were already building some sort of weird metaverse before that even existed, you know? So just listening to them, it just sounds like, I don't know, like they have it all planned out, you know. I thought that was pretty rad.
Thanks. Just figuring it out as we go.
Yes. we're stumbling along.
Yeah, but we're super grateful for this collaboration though, because that's what forced us to have a deadline, right? Because you always have these ideas, like we have a million ideas of things that we want to do, but there needs to be something that's that forcing mechanism that makes you actually get it out there into the world, past in your brain or in your sketchbook, right? So thank you to everyone who's involved in this project for making us all jump in there together.
So, you know, what would you say would be the biggest challenge kind of going through this project? Was it the setup process? Was it thinking or selecting the artwork? Was it connecting your MetaMask wallet? Like, what was it for you guys? What was the most challenging part of this whole process?
I think for us, it was that the wallets and things like that. Especially because in Hawaii, we don't have access to certain platforms that'll make, you know, those wallets easier to open. And so, you know, just having to transfer money from our physical bank here in Hawaii into Gemini and then transferring that to MetaMask to then pay the gas fees. Like there's a certain amount of time wait that happens. So just to get the money transferred from our physical bank into our Gemini takes about 5 business days. And in the metaverse, that's a crazy amount of time, right? Like so much can happen in 5 days as far as gas prices and all that kind of stuff. So that was the most challenging part, is to coordinate those things. So that's where, you know, Matt met with Jasper and Lucky and sat down. I was like, okay, how do we get this done? You know,
you're a loan shark.
Right? Yeah. Yeah. Jasper had to loan us money so that we could get it in faster. So we didn't have to wait for the physical bank and then we could pay him.
200% interest.
But he was going to send his thugs to break my legs.
He's like, they owe me like 10F at this point.
Yeah. We have Jasper, our next child, basically. but yeah, just that kind of technological stuff.
How about the rest of you, Char or Aaron?
You know, I think that's one of the biggest barriers of entry is being in Hawaii and exploring and investing in crypto and NFTs, is that one of the biggest barriers of entry is, one, yes, cryptos are super expensive, but two, we only have small local banks in Hawaii and they're not. And oftentimes, sometimes like the technology, for the banking technology here in Hawaii is behind. And so when you have to try to either utilize one of the crypto bank account type sort of sites like Gemini or Coinbase, you can't even use Coinbase in Hawaii. So with Gemini, like you have to literally wire money to Gemini in order to even like open your account. Whereas like other banks, it's like you just click it and then like automatically sort of links. And here it's like, I got to go to the bank, I got to wire it to like a Gemini account, and it shows, and it's just like so many more steps. So if we can sort of solve some of those issues where it's like more accessible, then they'll probably help people to sort of explore them better. Because right now it's like, it's a whole thing right now.
Aaron, you were going to say something?
Yeah, it was just basically just the setup part was really confusing for me. And plus I was on the road, so a lot of the meetups I couldn't make. So I had to, you know, I had to rock the YouTube University for a little bit, for a bunch of it. And then of course Annie and Jasper was a huge help. And it was like almost like having anxiety, like trying to, because it was down to like I had only like 3 hours before the drop or something, and my stuff didn't get minted. So I was just freaking out like hardcore. But now that everything is set up and you know, my piece sold, I was just really stoked and relieved. And now I'm in the space and it's the first step, you know?
Cool. How about Char, Lucky? Easy process for you, not much to worry about?
I think the setup was fine, I guess. It was more so me just trying to like find where we keep our crypto. Because again, I just don't think I personally ever took it seriously enough. We keep most of our crypto in a nano, like a little external wallet. Mm-hmm. And my sister got that for us years ago and gifted it to us with a whole bunch of Ethereum when it was really cheap. And of course I'm thinking like, sick, I think we have a whole bunch of Ethereum in there. No, it turns out we sold it a long time ago for like some Ripple or something stupid like that. So it was like kind of, I found that out like thinking like, oh, I'll be fine because I have Ethereum already. No, then I was like super stressed out. So not realizing like our banks take so long to like get all that stuff processed, but all good. Like, just like what was like, I was like up to the last minute and I was freaking out in a hotel with terrible internet. And, but thankfully we all pulled through.
Cool. Any thoughts, Lucky? Or yeah.
Yeah, I think I was the same. Like, maybe I was awake till like 3 o'clock in the morning and trying to like wait for the gas fee and stuff like that. But I actually met Jasper twice and just connecting everything, and I just didn't want to do it wrong. But I think what a lot of people don't realize is that there are like 4 transactions that need to get made in order to mint the NFT. And that's why they're so expensive, because one, you need to figure out how much you want to sell it for, and what crypto is, and if it's, you know, rising and falling price of ETH, or and then just a little stuff like a $30 charge for, you know, moving your crypto to MetaMask to MakersPlace to mint to NFT. So now I understand why it costs a little bit more. It's not just like, oh, this is $100 and it's just easy to get, you know, anybody can get it or whatever. I mean, but thankfully some people have crypto money that they invested in early, so they don't mind spending a little bit more. But yeah, just the process of doing it. But I think now that we've all done it at least at once, I think it's a little bit easier to do. So I'm glad that that's done, because I was having stress and anxiety and stuff. It's like, Jasper, what do I do? How do you do this? So, but I'm glad I did it. I'm glad I did it for sure.
I mean, Lucky took like the next step. Like he bought a computer just for this project.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, I have this computer behind me is like 6 years old. It was gifted to me. It's not my computer. And I was like, oh, I don't want to do crypto on this computer. I just do it on my phone, you know? And I was like, oh my God. So I went to Costco, bought a computer. Get Jasper, set this up. He even has all my codes. He could steal all my
money.
He could steal all my money from my MetaMask if he wanted to.
I like tattooed the C phrases onto my body so I can steal this crypto.
Wow. Out of your NFT skin.
Yeah, it's like armpits.
My MetaMask password.
What? It's like some crazy one.
Well, so, but you know, now that all of you, congratulations, you made your entry into the NFT world, you know, what would be your advice for artists who are thinking of taking the plunge to get into this space? Since you've gone through it yourself, what would you encourage them to think about before they, you know, they make the move?
To be honest, like, I think it's really having realistic expectations, you know? Like, I think people see other artists and they're like, oh, wow, these guys are like, so many of these artists are like really making a lot of money, and then they think it's like a quick cash grab. But at the end of the day, it's not. You really have to build your reputation and try a lot of different things to sort of, you know, get known within that world. And also, it's such a big barrier of entry, you know, like just on cost. Like, if you don't already have crypto, to buy into crypto now costs so much money. So it is really like a big risk until they change it. I mean, obviously there's like other change, you know, you can talk about to Solana or other ones which are cheaper, instead of like the ETH blockchain, until they release like ETH 2.0 or something, well, we're hoping proof of stake will be cheaper. But right now it's like the barrier of entry is just so high right now. So I would say, you know, really make a game plan, try the different platforms, you know, check out like do your research, you know, like whether you're putting it up on OpenSea or whether you're putting on MakersPlace or Nifty or Foundation or Rarible or Super Rare, etc. There's so many of them, and put it up and see what happens, you know. And don't be disappointed if it doesn't sell right away, you know, because I've had stuff that took like 7 months to sell, and it's just the way it is in that world. It's really sort of, and also, you know, start building your reputation within the platforms that crypto enthusiasts spend their most time in, which tends to be Twitter and Discord, you know, and join Discord channels and promote your work. It's not like everyone's like hungry to buy an NFT and then you release one and everyone's going to buy it right away. It's not like that at all, you know. And so it's really sort of doing the research and having realistic expectations, I think, because then some people are just. And also trying to like bring value to the community. Like the crypto community and NFT community they're really into sort of supporting each other. You know, if you're a part of different communities, like, you know, some of the words they like to use are like WAGME, you know, everyone says good morning to each other. It's like kind of like a nice community. Like everyone's trying to like, it's like really supportive of each other, which is really cool. So, you know, if you start building your rep within these communities, like they'll support you, whenever you're doing projects. And so it's good to sort of be active within there and try your best, but I would say definitely explore, you know, definitely try, do it and see what happens.
Any thoughts from the others?
Yeah, I would just try it out.
Good.
Oh, well, like, let's go.
No, I was just going to say, like, having a plan, like, if you wanted to get into NFTs, like, because once you drop one and say it sells, what are you going to do, right? Like, so if I was new to this again, and I would have planned it out a little bit better, like a sequence or a series, or what do I want to promote? Like, you guys, your idea of having the start of your piece and then the name of it will change, and then you're building like ecosystem or whatever. But yeah, like come into it with a plan. Like, you can't just put one out there and just expect it to sell. Sometimes you do and it hits, right? But I think for me, if I do this again, I'm gonna try to formulate some sort of like, okay, I got, like, it's like doing like streetwear clothes or something, you know, you need like a spring, and then I need like, oh, my next line drop or whatever. So that's definitely my advice to somebody new, like, don't just put one up and think it's gonna sell right away, because if it doesn't, you're gonna be like, oh man, and then you're just gonna lose interest, you know, plus it costs quite a bit of money too. That would be my advice. Make some sort of a plan and don't have such high expectations.
No, that sounds great. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think similarly, that would be my advice, is to think of it in terms of a collection. So like how you were saying, like a capsule collection, you know, of spring or summer, or that kind mm-hmm. of thing, where you have, you know, three pieces that can at least stand on their own as a little group. And then, you know, if you change your mind and decide to do something different, at mm-hmm. least that little group lives on its own, and that was its own little jam. And then you can do something different, or you can expand on it. And I think people are really forgiving, you know, it's a really new space. So not to put any pressure on yourself as far as, you know, having to have something perfect. You know, use something that you already have that's existing that you really love and put mm-hmm. it out there. I think it does help if you have like a little caption or a story that goes along with it, because we live inside our own heads a lot and we know the meaning behind our own pieces and why we love it so much, but mm-hmm. our audience doesn't know that. So you have to tell them, you know, what is it that you loved about this piece? Is it about a certain person? Is it about a certain emotion? Mm-hmm. Is it this character that you've developed that has these certain traits, you know, make us fall in love with it because you love it, right? So make us see what it is that's so magic about it.
So the storytelling aspect of it, it's actually really important, I think, in the NFT space as well. You know, to build that connection between you and someone that you probably never meet in real life, you know. So that's, yeah, I mean, I really love reading, you know, all your write-ups for your different art pieces. Char or Aaron, any thoughts? What would you advise people jumping into the space, or artists specifically jumping into space for the first time?
I think it's a great platform, and it's just a different, you know, a different way to promote your creativity. And I like it because it's totally strange to me, you know, and it kind of took me back to when I first got into even painting. Like, it's a whole new platform and it's a whole new world. So it's like, you know, I've been painting the same iconic character for like over 20 years, like I said earlier. So to like get into this space and try to figure out other things and maybe even get into 3D and AR and all that stuff is just like a whole new school for me. So just having fun with it, you know what I mean? Like why we all got into art in the first place. It was just something really cool to do and something that you love to do, and this is just another platform for you to push your art, you know. It's cool.
Thank you. Or any thoughts, last thoughts before I let you guys go?
Yeah, that's the same thing. I think it's just, it's about like just that hunger that all of us probably have to challenge ourselves and to grow, and it's happening, you know, whether or not you get into it. And it's just kind of, it's a fun thing to do to keep pushing yourself and just continuing on your art education, and it looks like something completely different than you ever thought it would look like, but it's super fun. I think it's fun to challenge yourself.
Awesome. Thank you so much, everyone. I have like 5,000 other questions, but you know, we agreed that, you know, we would keep this to an hour. So maybe, you know, we could have future like smaller webinars and breakouts where, you know, we can go deeper into this topic. And, you know, if you have other new projects that we can share with Hawaii and the world, we can always do something in the future together as well. But I wanted to say thank you to all of you, you know, for number one, of course, jumping on this bandwagon with us. Not sure if all of you know, the DCIL is the, you know, we are trying to change Hawaii to make it more crypto friendly. So helping, you know, to change the regulation and even the legislation so that we can have crypto companies do business here in Hawaii. But what you guys did for us, it's kind of a, you know, I would say a practical use application of crypto and why, you know, it's important in terms of economic benefits for Hawaii and artists like yourself. So thank you so much for, you know, jumping on this bandwagon and this project with us.